Final Cut Pro 11 is here. And you're late. And after having looked at the amazing magnetic mask, transcribe to captions, and spatial video editing, all of which you can see in this playlist up here, we finally want to take a look at a bunch of great new big and small workflow improvements. So last, but most certainly not least, the seemingly small additions and changes in Final Cut Pro 11. And these aren't just a few, most of which I think prove that Apple is very much listening to ideas and requests. Some you maybe didn't realize you were missing until now. From hiding clips, keyboard shortcuts, great new effects, and more. Let's dive in, and I'd love to hear what you think down in the comments. To start things off, there's a brand new versatile and very clever hide command for the browser. Until now, the only way to hide any media from the event browser that you deemed important enough to keep, but not important enough to see, even if only temporarily, you really only had the filtering options contained within the clip filtering menu above the event browser. Here, the only way to hide any clips was to reject them, and then select Hide Rejected, which in itself is very powerful, but not ideal for every organizational situation or need. But now we get an even more granular level of organization to simplify the overview in our event browser, regardless of the media's rating. To use this, I simply right-click any given clip or clips that I have selected, and select Hide Clips, or use the keyboard shortcut Option H. As I've said before, if you're using a custom keyboard layout, you will not see this or any other new keyboard shortcuts, in case you were wondering why it might not be showing up on your end. With that, the clips disappear from sight no matter how I filter the event browser. And as usual, there are multiple ways of unhiding them again. For one, you can go into the View menu and the Browser submenu and select Show Hidden Clips, or hit the keyboard shortcut Option Shift H. But probably the easiest, next to using the keyboard shortcut, is to go into the Clip Appearance and Filtering menu at the top of the browser and check the now new option to Show Hidden Clips here. In any of those cases, the previously hidden clips reappear. If you look closely, those clips now also have a new icon with a crossed out eye at the top left to signal which will be hidden if you invoke the hide command. To keep any and all of them from being hidden again, you simply select them and right click, then select unhide clip or clips, or simply press the Option H keyboard shortcut again. With that, the little eye icon also disappears. Okay, so which part of this is clever, as I said before? Well, if you select any two or more clips, right-click them and choose either Synchronize Clips or New Multicam Clip, in both cases, you will now see an additional checkbox to hide the original clips after creating the synchronized or multicam clip. That's really smart, since I personally always felt it unnecessary to see the originals after creating such clips in probably 99% of the cases. So I think this is a superb idea, especially if you have multicams consisting of a bunch of different camera angles. Selecting this and creating my multicam, assuming I have chosen not to show hidden clips, we see how all the original clips automatically disappear, and I'm only left with the multicam itself visible. One of those little but ever so practical features. Love it. Next up, some new and very useful timeline navigation. Again, those that have watched my previous tutorials will probably already know that Apple added a small but super useful feature a while back that allows you to select a clip or media in the timeline and to then simply press the command key and the left, right, or even up and down arrows. That moves the selection to the nearest media that has the same role assigned. So if I have a title selected, for example, pressing command and the left and right arrows only cycles through titles across the timeline. The same, of course, goes for audio. So even though these audio clips are next to each other in this connected storyline, selecting one with the red insert role assigned to it and pressing command left or right arrow skips the other audio clips with the brown colored role.
Something that I have found extremely useful since day one and use almost daily. For example, if I have a bunch of titles where I want to change the font or content or whatever, I simply select one, make the changes I want, and now, instead of going all the way back down to my timeline with my mouse to select the next one and go back up to the inspector, I simply hit Command, left, right, up or down arrow while staying in the inspector to immediately make those changes. Really makes an otherwise tedious task so much easier. Well, now there is a new very similar shortcut for moving connected clips up and down. All I need to do is select any given connected media that may be over or under another connected clip and hit Option instead of Command and the up or down arrows to move it up or down in the hierarchy. Even if the selected media is all the way below the primary storyline or isn't, and I want to move it there. This is especially useful since sometimes dragging media between connected clips can be a bit finicky. I can even do this with multiple selected objects at the same time, even if they are in entirely different parts of the timeline. So now I can combine both shortcuts, the Command and arrow keys to select an item in the timeline, and then Option and the up and down arrows to move it up and down, all without once touching my mouse. Really great. Yet another shortcut that I know I use not only once, but many, many times every day, Shift-Z. If you actually don't know about this shortcut, then I pity you. It works in all areas of the interface. Pressing it in the browser adjusts the time representation setting for all the media's film strips to all. In other words, reduces even the longest clip to a single thumbnail. Pressing it in the viewer after I've zoomed the clip in or out with Command plus or minus fits it back into the window. And of course, using it in the timeline fits the entire content of the timeline into the window as well. But unfortunately, until now, only horizontally, which in itself is super helpful, but sometimes if you have very complex timelines with stacks of clips or titles on top of each other, you still had to either scroll up and down to actually see the entire content or adjust the clip height manually in the timeline's clip appearance menu. Well, now, if you're in the timeline and you hit Option Shift Z, Final Cut does a vertical zoom, or rather adjusts the clip heights setting so that the content of the timeline fits into the window vertically as well. I totally love this. This goes both ways, by the way. In other words, if you have a timeline with very little in it, hitting Option Shift Z automatically adjusts the clip height to the biggest possible size to fit everything into the timeline window. There are a couple of really cool and useful new effects, too. If you look in the effects browser, you'll find a new reframe category. Here you'll find two new effects, both of which are very cleverly made. Starting with the callout effect, this is a seemingly simple but very flexible new effect. You just apply it to the clip where you want to highlight something, and move the playhead somewhere to the middle of the clip so you can see the result. Now you can use the on-screen control with the circle around it to define the starting point and the amount of scale. Simply clicking and moving the box itself around defines where the selected section will animate to. And of course, adjusting the selection box defines the size and shape of the image crop. And as a little power user tip, holding the Option key while dragging any of the corners of the selection box scales it from the center, so you don't have to reposition it every time after adjusting the size. Holding down the Shift key, on the other hand, locks the current aspect ratio of the selection as you scale. And, of course, holding both Option and Shift at the same time does both at the same time. Once finished, you can play it back, and you'll see that the build-in animation happens within the first second of the clip, and the build-out within the last second, with the callout itself lasting for the duration of the clip in between. I won't go into all the other settings in the inspector, since I think they're fairly self-explanatory, and would recommend just playing around with it for a bit. It's very cool. Then there is the new Picture-in-Picture effect, which you set up and control pretty much identically to the callout effect, only that you apply it to a second clip above your main clip, since obviously you need another picture for your picture, as the name suggests. Again, you simply apply this to, in this case, a clip on top of another, and use the same on-screen controls to adjust size and position, as well as any cropping you might want. The biggest difference to the callout effect being that you also have a long list of animation styles to choose from, all of which, as with the callout effect, animate within the first and last second of the clip it's applied to. You can have the entire screen simply scale down to the chosen position, scale and crop, or have it move in from various sides of the frame. Again, I would suggest just playing around with it for a bit. Another very cool and useful effect. Next to these, there are also five new modular transitions in a new category of the same name. And while these might appear to be just some run-of-the-mill wipe effects at first glance, you might even ignorantly dismiss the Shapes Inset transition, for example, because it shows a star. Maybe pay attention to the name. It's Shapes Inset, not Star Inset. In other words, if you apply this and actually take a look at its options and parameters in the inspector, you'll see that there are in fact not only 9 shapes to choose from, but it also has a unique swap option that the others don't, allowing you to decide if the incoming clip is the revealing or the one being revealed. In the end, actually making this the most versatile transition of the bunch. And taking a closer look at them, you can see that some have pretty much the exact same on-screen controls as the reframe effects, as well as a bunch of animations and other parameters to choose from, allowing you to create really interesting visual reveals. They also have a nice subtle and smooth animation, which again happens during the first and last second of the transition. So if you'd like the effect, such as the side-by-side split, for example, to linger for any period of time, you simply extend the transition. In other words, if any of these transitions are the default 2 seconds long, it will animate in and back out immediately. So you wouldn't want to shorten any below 2 seconds since you'd cut off the animation. But if you make it 5 seconds long, for example, then it animates in, holds for 3 seconds, and then animates back out. And if you disable the build-in and build-out animations, then you can even use these for a very quick and easy way of doing a hard cut in and out of a split screen. Again, I recommend just playing around with them a bunch to see all the possibilities. Then there is the small but extremely useful change in the list view of the event browser. For anyone who has needed to go in and either add or change text in the notes field, for example, or change any editable metadata, will probably have become somewhat frustrated, because until now there was no way of quickly and easily moving from one metadata field to the other. Having to click each field with the mouse obviously slowed down the whole process considerably. But now, starting with Final Cut 11, if you have an active field and you want to move vertically either to the previous or next clip's text field, you simply hit Option and the arrow key up or down. Now you can immediately start typing away and quickly move on to the next or previous clip to do the same. And if you want to move horizontally, so to the next or previous metadata field of the same clip, you simply hit the Tab key to move to the right, or Shift and the Tab key to move to the left. One of those little improvements that shows that Apple is listening, especially to pro users. There are also a slew of additional very useful and requested commands that can be assigned a keyboard shortcut. Those commands include consolidate motion templates, expand collapse subrolls, paste time code, play forward reverse half speed, rename timeline clips, show hide audio lanes, show horizon, and others. If you can't remember which shortcut a particular command that's of interest to you has, you simply hit Option Command K and search for it in the command editor. Further, seemingly small improvements that I think will make a big difference in some people's workflows. Then there are the last couple of changes and additions that I would say fall into the category of good to know, since probably not of grave importance to the vast majority of users. First off, there are new framerate options. If I simply hit Command N to create a new project, give it a name, and leave it set to automatic, meaning that it'll set the video properties of the project based on the first video clip that I edit into the timeline. If I click OK, the project opens, and if I take this slow motion clip, identified by the little ring icon at the top, that was shot with 120 frames per second, and press the E key to append it to the timeline, as it's been up until now as well, I'm told that the clip's properties are not standard and I'm asked to select appropriate settings to best match the clip. Now, if for some reason I wanted to actually edit this clip at its full 120 frames per second, looking in the pop-up menu for the frame rate, we'll see that it's already set to the highest possible value of 60p. So where are these new frame rates? Well, if I go into the video format menu and select custom settings at the very bottom, and this of course goes for creating a new project using the custom settings as well, we can see the frame rate automatically jumps to 120p. Clicking on the frame rate menu now shows us that we have been given three additional frame rates to choose from. A 90, 100, and the 120 frame per second option. Not something that I have personally ever missed in the past, since this of course negates any possibility of doing a nice slow-mo with high-speed clips, for example, but I'd say that these options are of particular use for editing spatial video, since higher frame rates obviously will mean better parity with the refresh rates of a Vision Pro, for example, in turn reducing eye strain, especially with titles or graphics that you add, since those will render at the full frame rate. As an example, in this 120 frames per second timeline, if I add this 30 frame per second spatial video and a standard Tumble 3D title on top of it, if I step through the title frame by frame, we can see that while the clip only updates every 3 frames, as expected, the title itself updates for every one of the 120 frames, since titles come in as both resolution and frame rate agnostic. So, that is a use case that I would see being very useful, assuming the ability to play video at 90, 100, or 120 frames per second. Or, is this maybe something that you have always wanted or needed for a use case that I can't think of? Then let me know down in the comments. I'm always interested in discovering unique workflows and editing needs.
I also just want to mention that Final Cut 11 adds support for third-party video decoders and format readers with a new media extension framework in macOS Sequoia. With it, third parties, whoever that may be, can easily add codec support for their proprietary formats. Unfortunately, I don't have a practical example to show you since, as of the making of this video, no one has released anything. But I'd say there really aren't any excuses left for any third party that you can think of to not add any needed and missing support to Final Cut. We'll see. So that was my fourth chapter covering everything new in Final Cut Pro 11. Which feature or workflow improvement is your personal favorite? I'd love to hear from you down in the comments. And if you haven't seen the other chapters, you can check out the previous one here or even the entire playlist down here where you can choose what's of the most interest to you. Either way, thanks for watching and I look forward to seeing you in the next one. Take care.